I'd like to introduce our own Dr. John Rosko to talk about water.
Well, I don't have to speak anymore. You just did it. Everybody can go home. My goodness. This is a common element, a common theme, sustainability. Some of you guys may have been here last year when we did global warming and all these other things. I'm going to try to tie together a couple of ideas. First of all, amplifying what Steve has been talking about. How do we keep our freshwater systems clean? Can we go back and reclaim areas that are, have been destroyed? Our water quality in some areas is terrible. Can we go back and rebuild some of that? Can we create new water? And we see a whole bunch of problems brewing on the horizon in the world. Can we avoid them? Can we mitigate them somehow? So basically what I want to do is tie all these little ideas together, and the first thing I guess is going to be a reality check. Let's have that first pie, Steve. Take a look at the distribution of water on this planet. Now, of course, you can see 98% salt water. That's the ocean. You guys have all been swimming in the oceans. You go out there and get a mouthful and spit it all out. That stuff is unavailable for our uses. You can't wash with it. You can't drink it. You can't use it on your crops. You can't use it for irrigation. And you can't even use it in industry because it's corrosive. Totally unavailable. Notice only 2% fresh. And if you start looking at that, you can see how much trouble you have. 87% of that is locked up in glaciers, ice, snow. Usually way away from population centers, also unavailable. Leaving you very little over here in the rivers, lakes, standing water that we utilize. Now, can you convert salt water into fresh water? The answer is yes, you can. There is the possibility that in the future we might be able to make new water, but not now. Your difficulty is the cost. You guys have to live in this area, the tri-state area, if you have United Water and you read their bills, boring. But they come up with all kinds of formulas and whatever, they do it in cubic feet of water, so it's tough to figure it all out. But basically, if you do it and finally figure it all out, you're paying in the tri-state area about a penny to 2 cents a gallon. Now, in some areas of the world, they can actually take the salt water, desalinate it, and make fresh water from it. They do it in Saudi Arabia, they do it in the Arab Emirates, they do it in Japan. If you've ever been on one of those big cruise ships, 3,000 people, especially if they're Americans, right? 3,000 Americans, how are you going to bring enough water? They will desalinate right on the ship. How much does that cost? Right now, to make a gallon of water by desalination is about $3 to $4. $3 to $4 compared to maybe a penny or 2 cents. I mean, right now, it is cost prohibitive. I mean, nobody can really do this on an economical basis. We need an engineer who's going to come up with an idea. Now, of course, a lot of my Gen Bio people are here, and one of the techniques they use, watch them cringe, is going to be osmosis, a reverse osmosis. You guys know that if you took fresh water and salt water, and you put a membrane between them, fresh water goes through. Could you put pressure on the salt water and squeeze it through? Reverse the osmosis process? The answer is yes, you can, and that's how most of them do it. But it is ridiculously expensive. So right now, the amount of water on this planet is constant, and I don't see anybody coming up with any way of doing this in an economical way, not in the future. Now, since we don't have any new water, I'm gonna put that second one up there, Steve. What actually is happening to the water is it is recycling. The water that you have in your body right now, could have been in a glacier, was probably in the Atlantic Ocean or the Pacific Ocean or in the groundwater, or if you're a history people, the water inside of you could have been in Alexander the Great, could have been in George Washington, could have been in Madame Curie, could have been in Adolf Hitler, anybody, take anybody in history. Water is constantly, you're a temporary vessel for water. You drink it, release it, I'll be delicate about some of this, you know how you release it, and it goes back into the ecosystem and then continues to cycle. The stuff inside of you is probably in the sewage treatment. Look at the faces.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we just do this and show you what is going on. Our generator, of course, is the sun. The sun is going to hit the ocean right here. This is salt water, that's the stuff that's unavailable. Sunlight hits it, and you wind up evaporating water. The water that evaporates is fresh. That's the stuff that we can use. That's the stuff you can bathe, you can drink, and all of that. And you'll see some of it actually falls right back into the ocean, but some of it drips inland. in the form of clouds. And there, of course, you start your precipitation. What could happen? Well, some of it could be locked up in glaciers, things like that, unavailable again. Some of it could run directly right out, right back into the ocean. There's that, of course. But some of it also will flow downstream into that little standing water pump. That, of course, is going to be the water that we're using. Everybody has, you know, reservoirs and things like that. So this part right here is really what we like. We want to be able to use that water. Now, you might notice underground here, a lot of the water also seeps into the ground and becomes groundwater that has to be tapped usually through a well or something along those lines. Now, if you start looking at this and you understand the cycle, ask yourself, how many ways can we screw this up? And of course, the answer is plenty of ways. What if the air warms up? Warm air holds more water. So with global warming, and of course, we haven't raised the temperature of the air at about 1.3 degrees Fahrenheit in 50 years, that means more water being transported inland. Now, you might say, yay team, it's going to fill this up. But there are hurricanes brewing. And a lot of times, that extra water can come down in the form of a massive gush, flooding, all kinds of damage and danger that way. If hot water, if hot air holds a lot of water, Dr. Johnson's got to be at least a tropical storm. All right, so there was just... So that is the entire cycle right here, and recycling all around. Now, what could we do? This is really a global picture. Could you break it down into smaller units that we could manage? Dr. Burns used the word watershed. Have you ever heard that one? A watershed.
Yeah.
A watershed is kind of like a little piece of this. And the next slide, Steve, will show you what we mean by a watershed. So really look at this as kind of like, you know, a subset of the big picture here. And this is probably an easier way to deal with what goes wrong. This here, of course, shows you rainfall in a given area. And the question is, where does that water go? If you are in a watershed, for example, we are in the Sparkill Creek watershed, all the rain that falls out here is going to work its way into the creek. Most of it is going to be surface flow running in. Otherwise, it's going to go down into the groundwater and come in. But it's going to all eventually collect in a given body of water. Now, of course, it doesn't have to stop here. If this is the Sparkill Creek, it's going to flow into the Hudson River. So, our watershed, our current watershed right here, all the rain that falls on the campus, including parts of, if you guys are local, parts of Bloorville, obviously Sparkill, Orangetown, Tappan, Piermont, and even a little bit of northern New Jersey, Bergen County, will all flow into that. And ultimately, if you follow this creek down, it goes down into the Piermont marshes and enters the Hudson River. So even though we have a watershed here that we can isolate, it's part of a bigger one. And of course, put it all together, take all the watersheds in the world, what do you got? You're right back to your hydrologic cycle for the entire planet. So it's kind of just like a small way of looking at it. Now, if you look at this, what here can go wrong? Well, you might notice something interesting here, and that is most natural waterways meander, like this. We don't like that. Most of the time, what we will do is we will build conduits, pipelines, and all kinds of things like that to make the water run nice and straight. We don't like the curvy things here. That's, you know, typical of humans. So what happens to that water now? Add into it, right? We're gonna build a town right here. Put a city down, sidewalks, driveways, concrete, impervious water layers. Water doesn't go through that stuff. Starts raining, what's going to happen to the water at the bottom of your driveway? That water had formerly seeped into the ground. Now where does it go? In a gush. So what is going to happen with that water? Well, moving water, I don't know if you appreciate the power of moving water, but it is absolutely incredible. It causes erosion. It's going to rip up the banks of the little creeky here. It's going to rip it all up and deposit that mud somewhere. And of course, in my little creek, where is it going? It's going to cover the bottom. In some cases, Dr. Johnson and I have been out there, sometimes they're not mud, thigh high. You couldn't even get through the damn thing. A lot of fish lay their eggs on the bottom. Cover it with mud. And there you go. You're gonna eliminate many species of fish. Many algae will grow on the bottom of rocks and things like that. If the mud covered that over, you eliminate an important food source. We do that very much. We will make erosion. Humans create erosion. Now, I wasn't gonna talk about this one. I didn't know how squeamish the group was going to be. But as I look around, I think we might as well give it a shot. Of course, you got all people up here now. And of course, people produce waste material. And the question then becomes, what are you going to do with it? Now, of course, before 1970, the answer was easy. We flush it into the nearest body of water without any treatment at all. Pretty sad story, but you would take walks around the Hudson River and you wonder what all those brown things were out there floating around. That changed in the early 1970s. I mean this delicately, this is going to be tricky. In 1971, Congress passed the Clean Water Act. And basically what they did was they gave the states a whole bunch of money, $18 billion, which was big bucks in those days, to build sewage treatment facilities. The federal government picked up like 75% of the tab. The county and municipality had to pick up the rest. And they built all these types of treatments. And of course, that's what's going on across the street in the treatment facility over here. You flush, or you wash in the sink, or you wash your clothes, or you take a shower. All that water goes out of your house through that main pipe into the treatment facility. And there it is treated. Are they going to remove 100% of the material in there? Here we go again, it's cost prohibitive. They'll remove about 90%. Your problem is, it's gonna cost you as much, maybe even more, to remove that last 10 or 15% of the waste than it did to remove the first 85%. Of course, I mean, there's a lot of money involved in here. But how do you get rid of that waste material? So one of the sources is definitely gonna be sewage treatment facilities, especially in certain parts of the country. There are parts of Long Island and even parts along the lower Hudson where they have combined sewers. Now, what does that mean? When it rains, all that water that's washing into these sewers, does that get treated? No. It's too expensive. And why treat it? Rainwater's clean. Why treat it? Treatment is very expensive. However, some municipalities were never able to, they didn't have the money, were never able to make a separate sewer system for the stormwater and the sewage and have combined sewers. Which means when it does rain, that goes through the sewage treatment plant. And if it's a big gush of water, guess what it's going to bring out? You'll probably get partially treated sewage. This appeared in the summer. That's in water safe. Safe for what? Safe for swimming. Drinking? I don't think so. They're talking about this river, have not met federal standards, blah, 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 contract. That's what sawmill has failed to meet the requirements 3/4 of the time. Our mighty Sparkill Creek has failed 95% of the time. That is to say, we have too much organic material, nitrate, phosphate, a whole bunch of other things monitoring the water. Now, why should you care? What is the New York State emergency drinking water? The Hudson River. I don't think I'd want to drink that stuff. Not right now. But I will tell you this. The water has improved. The water quality has improved in the Hudson River. It's going to take a while. But the blue crabs are back, and many of the creatures that were there when the water was clean are returning. There are still problems with it. Absolutely. No question about it. Getting better, but you're not there yet. What happens if we have a water emergency? Some terrorist throws a whole bunch of water, poison in the reservoirs or some crazy stuff like that, blows up a dam or whatever. You gotta get water somewhere. This is our emergency plan. We are really in trouble. I mean, this is very safe for swimming. They also say, don't swim after a rain. Maybe you understand now why. If you have combined sewers and you get a gush of water going through, guess what you're also gonna get? Now, it's a rarity today in this area, but many people are far away from the sewage treatment facilities, and it's cost prohibitive to hook them up to sewers. So they have a septic system. Now, a septic system, which, thank God, are disappearing rapidly in the area, but we still have them in Rockland. There's still a couple of them down by Piermont. What is a septic system? They put a concrete box on the ground. That's basically what it is. And when you flush, it goes into that septic system. Solids then tend to stay at the bottom, liquids rise, and slowly the bacteria carry out decomposition. At the top of your septic system, you got pipes coming out. And they will send that water out to the different fields and distribute it that way. What happens in a heavy rain? you could get a big gush going into your septic system, washing through your fields, and entering the nearest water system. I don't care where you put your septic system, it's going to be in somebody's watershed. It's going to get out there somehow, and that stuff can gush into a river system. So, I guess the moral of the story is don't swim in the Hudson River after it rains, I suppose. Leave a couple of days or whatever. But you see what's going on here. That is one of the ways. Human waste material, which isn't a great resource, is being wasted. Human waste material is an excellent fertilizer. I mean, it has been used by civilizations for centuries. This stuff is very good. In fact, probably the best. Start looking at the balance of minerals in waste. Yeah, chicken waste is too acidy, rabbit waste is too acidy. The best combination? Human waste material. I don't see anybody using that, scooping it out and throwing it on their lawn. I just don't see this. I think we're probably going to be stuck with a treatment facility for quite a while here. But anyway, that is one of the big ones here. So we have a lot of erosion here. You got speeding up water. If that hot air holds more water, you might actually be increasing the number of storms that hit. Maybe we're increasing not the number, but the severity of those storms, because that's more water coming in at one time. And these systems are not designed to store excess water. The word we use, flooded. Watch the news. Not like, oh boy, we're going to recharge the groundwater, and we're going to fill up our reservoirs. The word they use, flooding. They're not equipped to do this. That water is just going to wash away. Very sad to say. So that is, again, another big problem that we have. Also, you could contribute. All the trees there, right? You carry out development. Can you leave those trees there? Better put homes there. Chop all that down. And those trees, of course, have deep root systems. They're gone. What happens when it rains now? Those roots, they were holding your soil in place. Now, all of a sudden, more erosion going on. And of course, in water, you are going to get not only erosion, you are going to get any other chemical or whatever that was in the soil. Human waste material poses two problems, I mean, basically. One of them is human waste material, as I said, is a good fertilizer, a lot of minerals in it. If you don't treat that properly and just push that back into the ecosystem, you're actually going to stimulate algae. Human waste material being a very good fertilizer, and I'll show you these couple of pictures here. I mean, everybody wants this. This is really cool, look at this, man. I have one down in front of my house, man. Look at that nice green lawn. That's all, there's a whole booklet here of lovely pictures of lawn. They use artificial fertilizer. You could use human waste. You're probably not going to, but I mean, you could theoretically use human waste to accomplish the same thing. You're gonna probably prefer the granular fertilizer, this stuff right here. Now, when you put it on your lawn, whatever, and it rains, all the minerals gonna get into the grass?
No.
They're going to wash through, they're going to enter your body of water, they're obviously in a watershed somewhere, and it's going to go somewhere. So you like this, and you many times get this. Matter of fact, I would argue, in summertime, go to any body of standing water in the tri-state area, any lake, river, stream, Hudson River, I don't care where you go, and find water that is crystal clear. You're not going to. Why not? That is eutrophication, that is too many minerals, and that causes major problems. That's a whole bunch of algae in there. And you might sit back, especially my ecology students, say, oh, wait a minute, algae, that's like food for fish, right? So that's a good thing here. Now we're going to be able out there and catch these big suckers. Oh man, it's going to be really great. Well, what's going to happen to the algae that's underneath the bottom algae? They'll like it. They're going to die. And they're going to fall to the bottom, where they're going to undergo decomposition. And as that happens, you use up oxygen. And that's the oxygen the fish breathe. So all of a sudden now, you've got a bunch of dead fish. And boy, is that going to stink. You can't get any oxygen going through. I mean, I have seen this around here. It's like a carpet on top of the water. No way you're going to get oxygen in. You have depleted the oxygen from the bottom. You are in an anoxic zone. There's no oxygen down there. It's going to start to stink. And of course, for our chemists, usually you'll get nitrates in your ecosystem. You get this, you're going to have ammonia. Normally you get carbon dioxide, you're going to get methane. Normally you have sulfates. Now you're going to get hydrogen sulfide. you know, rotten egg, and all that kind of stuff. It's going to stink. You're going to get dead fish. They're going to die. They're going to start to rot. It is not pretty, guys. I mean, you start doing this, eutrophication presents major problems. And if you drive over the Tappan Zee Bridge, don't watch the new bridge being built. It's crazy people taking pictures there. if you do this in the summertime with the sun hitting it, I mean, sometimes the Hudson River looks like pea soup. Fertilizer is a killer. I mean, fertilizer causes all kinds of difficulties. It doesn't just stay on your lawn. It's going to go into your watershed somewhere, and you know, it's going to drain out somewhere, and it's going to cause problems somewhere. How often should you fertilize? I mean, I'm sure many of you have a nice lawn in front of your house. I mean, maybe not like that. That's probably one of the greatest ones you're ever going to find here, or whatever, I don't know. But you probably have a nice green lawn in front of your house, and maybe you fertilize yourself. Maybe you have a lawn company, landscapers come in, I don't know, whatever. How often should you fertilize?
Should never.
According to the DEC, New York, 3 times a year. Memorial Day, Labor Day, and you're ready for this? Thanksgiving. What? Thanksgiving is the most important one. Because the plant, your lawn has stopped growing, yet they suck up the minerals. And sit there all winter, waiting for spring, just like we are. Hate winter. Waiting for spring. All of a sudden it gets a little warmer, little rain falls, and the grass starts turning green and starts growing very quickly. And you want that lawn to spread very quickly, because if you don't, the weeds come in. The government, by the way, introduced crabgrass in the 1830s on purpose as forage for animals. I could probably supply a herd of bison with my life. I got crabgrass the size of garbage can lids. If they gave a prize for it, count me in, I would win something. I mean, the crabgrass, absolutely insane. Best protection against it? Have a good lawn. Have grass. Can you plant the right type of grass? I know, GMOs are bad, or there's genetically modified organisms, we're going to have frankenfish, and we're going to have... I mean, these guys are working on having lawns, developing their own grasses that can take a lot of heat and grow with very little fertilizer. And that might be a great addition. But even if they don't have that right down the road, could you plant grass that's better? This is probably, this looks very much like ryegrass, perennial ryegrass. I've got that on my lawn. Probably you have it too. This stuff just requires a lot of water. That's all it is. You want your lawn to be like that. If you want your lawn to be like that, it's going to cost you a lot of fertilizer and a lot of water. I also have some zoysia grass in my corner there. That's Florida grass. You ever go to Florida and see the grass? I mean, the blades are very thick. They can withstand a lot of heat. I mean, all summer long, my lawn looked like the surface of the moon there. But the zoysia grass, nice and green. It looked pretty nice. I don't know if I want to do it all on my entire lawn, but when that stuff dies, often dies back in winter, it turns brown. It really looks crappy. But then when it grows, it's absolutely beautiful. You can actually have grass that does not require as much fertilizer, et cetera, et cetera. And maybe down the road, you're going to be able to come up and develop grasses that can survive under high heat and much less fertilizer. We do work with the Rockland Country Club. Those guys there, and you might look at it and say, actually many people have said, over the course of many years, probably the worst out there are those damn golf courses. I mean, even in the dead of summer, you go by there and they're all bright and green. Very interesting. They pour on fertilizer like a champ. Well, the Rockland Country Club doesn't. Matter of fact, we work with them to make sure that their nitrates and phosphates in their ponds or whatever are below the standard levels. They actually have attained Audubon status. Audubon status, really nice, which means they don't use as much water, they don't use enough much fertilizer, and they let some areas lay fallow. They don't grow grass. They let native grasses grow there. Well, kind of. Talk to the guys down there. We got a great idea here. Strip it all out, just leave it, all the native stuff will come in, and we'll have food for the deer and the birds, blah, blah, blah. He says, all we're doing is making it open for the invasives. There are some plants out there that will come in and just freaking take over. And many of them are ones that are introduced, some intentionally, some accidentally, and they just come in and wipe you out. I remember one summer driving up to visit my son in Binghamton, up on 17 there, middle of summer, and you look in the open field, and all you saw was purple loosestrife. be plant there that grows that'll actually crowd out everything else. You can buy this. You can buy the stupid plants in the plant store. Oh, they're pretty. Look at the purple plant. And they just take over. I mean, you can see these fields, mile after mile of just purple. Nothing here. I mean, that's not an ecosystem. I mean, that's a form for purple loosestrife, for God's sakes. You gotta have a bunch of different species in there. This doesn't work. I mean, absolutely horrible. So if you want to do that, and many people have recommended, cut your lawn out, put in some native grasses, native shrubs, native plants. You're gonna be working at it, because those damn invasives are gonna come in. If I did it, I know it's gonna be growing there. I mean, I am gonna have all kinds of weeds, and I'm gonna have that crabgrass, I'm sure, going absolutely berserk. All right, so anyway, these are all some of the important stresses that we see on these ecosystems here. You know, fertilizer, erosion, waste material all coming in, possibly a greater amount of storm surges and things like that. Now, I kind of put it all together on the next slide here, Steve, just to show you some of the threats to these watersheds. Some of them I've mentioned already. Development, I've shown you the sediment here, fertilizer, of course. Just pollution in general. Do you ever go look at a parking lot when the cars aren't there? And you see the little glops of oil on the ground? What happens when it rains? Now, I know oil and water don't mix. But you get a heavy rain, it's going to scoop up that oil. And of course, if it's part of a watershed, it's going to go somewhere into the nearest body of water. That might decompose, use up oxygen. But of course, oil slicks. Poison fish. Fish don't like oil. I mean, oil gets into their scales, into their skin. You can kill fish that way. I mean, crazy stuff is appearing in water systems. People are flushing their drugs down and all kinds of crazy, well, medications. I probably should have phrased that better. Flush their medications down. I mean, one guy was saying, in parts of the Mississippi, if you took a sample of water and drank it, you probably are being treated for antidepressants. They found so many freaking antidepressants in the water that people would just chuck it out or whatever. Absolutely insane. You know, you don't want it? What do you do with it? Wash it. That's pretty much what a lot of people do. New York City, and matter of fact, many municipalities, they have the poop scooper law. Take a doggy for a walk. Doggy poops on the street. If you left it, where's it going to go? If you understand watersheds, where's it going to go? It's going to wash off in the nearest body of water. New York City, it's going to wash off into the nearest, Hudson River or any of the water around there. So you're required, remember, it's not going to be treated, storm sewer. You're required to scoop it all up, take it upstairs, and flush it. Then it'll be treated. I mean, at least you'll know that if you flush it, it's going to get treated. Otherwise, it's going to wash right through. You are going to, again, contribute to that eutrophication. Notice that groundwater one. That's kind of interesting. A lot of water underground. Matter of fact, there's far more water underground than surface water. And if you are in a water-deprived area, we are not. I mean, we should at least be grateful here that we live in this part of the country where water is abundant and has always been abundant and is a pretty high quality. I mean, probably the best water in the country, New York City. I mean, they tapped 3 reservoirs up in the Adirondacks. And the pipes were built, I don't know, somewhere around 1870. You go upstate where the pipes are drawing that water from the reservoirs toward New York City, they're all leaking. And they are costing the city millions of gallons a day of water just seeping. There are parts up there where it's now swampy areas, lakes and things like that, just from the water that they are losing. But it costs billions to fix. Nobody has the money to fix it. So you just gotta live with it. But amazing amount of water you lost, yet we still have abundant water. You start going west and you're gonna start seeing problems. I mean, you need a lot of water to support trees. You start going out to the Midwest where there's grasslands. They don't have as much water. Actually, what are you talking about? That's where we grow our corn and wheat. What do you mean? Water-deprived area. So what do? They draw water up through wells for irrigation. They overdraw the groundwater. That groundwater down below is constantly being recharged by rain. They suck it all up and they lower the groundwater. And in many areas, lower the ground. The ground actually subsides and sinks when that water from underneath is withdrawn. They have pulled out the High Plains Reservoir underground, this High Plains Aquifer. They have drawn so much out of there that the claim by the government is it is going to take 100 years of rain to recharge it. They have drawn way too much out of this groundwater. They will run out. I mean, do I have to remind you what we're talking about? This is our breadbasket. The United States is one of the few countries that actually exports food. too many can do that. We grow that food, we need water. The amount of water that goes through a plant during the growing season, I mean, it's just it's scary when you start looking at it. As a matter of fact, I don't think I brought it with me, no, I didn't here, but to show you the hidden water that's out there. You buy a pair of blue jeans, you're actually buying 2,100 gallons of water, whether you know it or not. It's made out of cotton. Cotton's a plant. You've got to irrigate cotton. Cotton is notoriously inefficient at handling water. Draws it up through the roots, loses it through the leaves, and just keeps doing it. Thousands of gallons. I mean, utterly amazing. If you want to do something, I think I'm on my last slide, or not yet, but on the last slide. You know, essentially what you can do, if you feel like this is terrible, we've got to set this thing right. Are there things that you could do to help this situation here? And of course, part of it is grow your wildflower garden, change your lawn, don't fertilize as much. I mean, we have many of these things here, if you feel like you want to make a contribution. But they have withdrawn so much in that groundwater that many claim they are jeopardizing the future harvest of America. You guys, and you know, when you're ready and you start feeding your kids, how much are you going to be paying for a loaf of bread? I have no idea. I mean, the wheat, good God. They suck up water like a champ. You know, one bushel of wheat, 7,000 gallons. I mean, ridiculous numbers. Plants are very inefficient when it comes to handling their water. Nothing you can do about it unless you get some genetically modified plants that are better at it. They're working at it. And, you know, there are desert plants. There are plants that are adapted to those conditions. No question about it. They're just not plants you want to eat in most cases here. Yeah, I think I'll go and have a cactus salad tonight. I don't think it's going to catch on at all. But if you want to grow the stuff that we're used to, it's going to cost you a tremendous amount of water. You buy a new pair of shoes made of leather. That is probably 1,500 gallons of water you just put on your feet. Run that by me. What? What are you talking about? Where does leather come from? Leather comes from cows. It's cow dermis, cow skin. Oh, so we got to keep a cow alive. Oh, wait a second here. We got to give them a trough of water to drink. And then we got to give them food that we put water. Oh, yay. Start looking at it. You will put a pair of shoes on. It's going to cost, I don't know, 1,600 gallons of water. There's hidden water all over the place. And of course, if we export the food, many have said, you're also exporting water. I mean, all our water that we used, we're exporting water, getting all that out of there. We lost all that. So, I mean, does this bode well down the road? I don't know. I mean, there are some real questions about the quality of water. But you're going to have to curb eutrophication. You are going to have to recharge your groundwater. You are going to have to curb development, obviously, or do something to prevent that mud and yuck from coming in. And if you do that, can you return water back to the way it was? We think so. I mean, the Hudson River was bad in the 70s. It has come a long way back. The idea here is nature has an ability to repair itself if you stop the insults, if you stop pouring the fertilizer in, if you stop the erosions and everything else, and you start doing that. I mean, there are things also like the PCBs that are at the bottom of the Hudson. For many years, Monsanto, GE were producing PCBs. PCBs are large molecules that withstand heat. They can take thousands of degrees. Oh, that's great. We can put them in electric motors and capacitors and put them all in that kind of stuff. So they made them by the ton. And of course, back in those days, what do you do with your x-ray? Flush it out. That's what everybody did, flush it out. So it all accumulated in the sediment and the sand in the bottom of the Hudson River. And now what do you do with it? Because it gradually is going to work its way out. If you're in the mud, here comes a worm. Eats it. And that worm now has that contamination. And that worm then pops his little head up, and out comes a fish and eats him and absorbs that. Then a bigger fish comes along and eats him. And guess what's happening now? Oh my God, no, we got PCBs all over the damn place. Now they're in the fish. And of course, fishing has been banned in that area for the last 30 years, and I don't know if they're ever going to change it. It's going to take a long time. PCBs dropped, and then they've kind of plateaued. They're low, but they're not getting lower. So you have really degraded that area. Can we fix that? I mean, the amount of material that's contaminated, I mean, as one guy was saying, would fill Yankee Stadium 100 times. Huh? How much? What are you going to do with that? You're going to have to dig it up, add heat to it to break down the PCBs, and then put it somewhere else. He keeps refusing to pay for it, and they're back and forth in court, going back and forth. They've been doing that for 25 years. I don't know what the hell's going to happen there. Who's going to pay for all this mess here? But the plan is basically, we scoop up that contaminated mud. We take it inland. We dig a big pit. We line it with plastic. We put that stuff in there. And then we cover it over and hope it doesn't leach out. Well, where are you going to put it? How about Coho's? That's a nice city. They didn't like that. Matter of fact, this gave rise to the acronym, NIMBY. Not in my backyard. You can do it. We're in favor of the plan here, but you're not putting it near us. Oh yeah, but we're not putting it near, where are you going to put it? Right now, nobody is willing to take it. Oh, but it'll mean a bunch of jobs. Oh no, we ain't doing it. Are you crazy? We're going to take these PCBs and put them aside. What guarantee are you going to give me that? Remember, we're in a watershed here. What guarantee are you going to give me that's not going to wash out and wind up in my plants? Well, the engineers, how about the engineers? They've never done this before. I'm not taking their word for it. What are you going to do with it? Can you reclaim that? I don't know. Right now, it doesn't look good. But the lower Hudson, yes, they have reclaimed it. Many of the creatures have returned. Absolutely. So anyway, they hit pretty much all of those herbicides, pesticides. You probably have a lawn service. You probably have those guys come in and put, you know, weed killers down. Oh, we got to get rid of that crab. Yes, got to get rid of those dandelions. Oh, I got to get rid of dandelions. Yeah. So of course we got to put these chemicals down there early in the spring before the seeds emerge and before they germinate, and we kill all those guys out. Winds up in the water. Pesticides. You probably put in grub killer. I mean, look. Damn Japanese beetle grubs, whatever. They will eat the root systems of your grass, and your grass will be dead. You can put all the water you want on it, it'll be dead. Oh, we got to put the chemical on it and kill those guys there, too. That, of course, winds up in your watershed. All of those things. Metal. That oil that was in the parking lot has metal in it. Came from an engine. All those pistons going down cylinders are wearing down metal. You're going to find copper in there. You're going to find iron in there. You're going to find a whole host of metals. This coming October 17th, we are again going to go and do a Sparkill Creek cleanup. We did one last year. We pulled out, my guys over here, pulled out probably enough to build half a car, or maybe, I don't know. We've had four tires, and you get a battery here and there, and oh my God, you could probably put a damn car together by the time you're done. People dump stuff in there all the time. Might go buy tires, right? They're going to charge you to get rid of the old ones. Boom, you, we better take them and shred them, and you know, okay, so pay a fee. I'll come by at night and dump it. They called me and they said, could you get a bunch of really strong guys? We've got some chains. What? Yeah, people have dumped a couple of water heaters. There it is, a refrigerator, a couple of dishwashers that somebody dumped in the creek. We got to get them out. What? People are dumping all this kind of stuff. Now, there's a lot of metal in those things. Is it going to stay metal in that thing forever? It's going to rust. It's going to corrode. Freezing takes place. Metals will be leached out. And metals, of course, are very toxic. They throw freaking computers away in the creek. Computers have toxic metals in them. And you need to specially recycle them. You can't just throw those in the garbage. For those who don't know, you have a bunch of these things that you know are toxic. You got oil, paint, old computers, old electronics and things like that. The county will take them. They have a place, you go up on Palisades, exit 12, route 45, go up to the fire training center. There is a recycling place there. Put all your crap in the trunk, pull up. They won't even let you get out of the car. Pop your trunk, they take it. Thank you very much. We'll take care of this. Off you go. Otherwise, what are you going to do with it? You throw it out, it's going to leach out. Going to wind up in somebody's water supply. A lot of toxic material will do it. Eutrophication, I mentioned, remember all that green crap that's growing, overdrawing your groundwater, and of course your development, sediment smothering everything. You are looking at what goes on in the Sparkill Creek right there, and probably what goes on in watersheds throughout the country, probably throughout the world. You know, people don't even care what they throw into their watershed and have it leach out. I think that's it. Now, the final one. I know many people will say in ecology, think globally, act locally. And essentially here, there are some global problems that we are very much worried about. As Dr. Byrne said, you're running out of water, you have more people, 85 million new people every year on the planet, they need water, you don't have as much, you are losing it by contaminating it, and no longer that water is available, there is going to be competition for water. The United Nations uses the word water wars. Now, I mean, that doesn't mean a bunch of guys are super soldiers. That's not like a new TV show or something, water wars. If you have two, your watershed does not respect state boundaries. A watershed does not respect, you know, country outlines, things like that. Water just goes downhill and takes its sweet old time going down. Now, what happens if two countries share a water system? Well, you better hope they get along, because if Group A takes too much, they are really going to piss Group B off. And if Group B takes too much, boy, they're going to piss Group A off. Right now, Turkey has said that they are planning to build a dam on the headwaters of the Tigris-Euphrates. They are going to build a dam there, they're going to build a lake for their own use, and they're going to use that water for their agriculture, etc. Which means less water goes south to Syria and Iraq. Oh man, one more thing to fight over? Good Lord, I mean, where are you? And now have a water war on top of everything else? What the hell is ISIS going to do? Go to Turkey and blow up a dam? What the hell are they going to do? This is going to be crazy here. If they do that, I mean, you are going to, I hope you expect problems, because boy, they say they're coming. India and Pakistan both use the Indus River. And they're not exactly BFFs, let me tell you. They've been arguing since the 40s over Kashmir. And just as a little kicker, they both have nuclear weapons. Oh wow, is that going to be fun? You look at some of these and say, oh my God, get me out of town here. What is going on here? Vying for these limited supplies. And water is life. Without water, you don't grow plants. You can't feed your people. What are you going to do? Water scarcity, as we said here. You all heard the Pope. It comes along and got rid of this mass poverty in the world, etc., etc. But as Steve said, you look at some of these countries. I mean, 40% of the world doesn't get water piped in. 40%, which means you take your jug, usually the women, it's the wives, take the water jug and tool out there and go out in some cases 3, 4, 5 miles, spending maybe 5, 6, 7 hours to go get water just for the day. They put it on their crops, they cook with it, they wash with it, etc., etc., then go back and get some more. Now, if you do that, you're just carrying out subsistence farming. You're just getting by. How are you going to get the extra money so that you could escape poverty? Water scarcity is probably going to cause and continue poverty throughout the world. You're going to have to solve that poverty issue. How are you going to do it? You're going to have to come up with some way of getting water to these people. Desalination? That's kind of rough. Are you going to reroute rivers? The Russians have done that. Maybe do stuff like that. Can you build dams? Well, you can. You can hold that water. You know, it rains every year. Oh God, the rain just washes away. What we'll do is we'll build a dam and we'll catch it all. Well, you can do that, of course. The guys downstream aren't going to be too crazy about it. But, you know, dams have a limited life. They silt in. You know that, remember? Erosion brings material, goes to the dam, slows down, drops your mud. You got a problem. When they built the Aswan High Dam in Egypt, it was really very interesting. They built it back in the 50s. The Egyptians there, with the Russians' help, built this massive dam and flooded an area. Actually flooded a whole bunch of the Abu Simbel and, you know, all these antiquities, and they had to move them. Jackie Kennedy had been raising money to move all these statues and everything else like that. So they built this dam. Now, the Nile River had always been Egypt's blessing, because every spring, like clockwork, you would get the melt of the snow, you know, Kilimanjaro, all the areas, Kenya, and it all would rush toward Egypt. And it would come down, the water then would hit the flat area of Egypt, slow down, and spread out. And all that mud it was carrying drops. Now that mud has minerals in it. So you got all these Egyptians sitting there saying, okay, here come the rains, here comes our fertilizer. Free of charge, this is really gonna be good. Every year it comes in, slows down, drops in the field, you go out there with your little shovel, whatever they use, I don't know. Little shovel, turn it around, bingo. Free fertilizer. So they built the dam in the 50s. Well, there goes your free fertilizer. So what these guys had to do, they had to rent trucks, go all the way back behind the dam, rent barges, go out, scoop out the mud, put it on the, bring it on the trucks, go back and, oh my God, what a mess. Plus, of course, they cut down the nutrients going toward the Mediterranean. Fishery collapsed. Huh? Well, those minerals caused algae to grow. Little fishies came along and ate that algae. The big fishies came and ate them, and pretty soon you got a fishery. Now you don't have the minerals. You don't have a fishery. All those poor fishermen, out of business. I watched one show, and they had this guy from the University of Cairo, an ecologist. And they said to him, if you could, if they would listen to you and do exactly what you said, what would you tell them to do? And he just looked straight to the camera and said, blow the dam up. Blow it up. It is more trouble than it's worth. It causes all this problem. It's going to probably contribute more to poverty of, you know, people down there in the Delta than anything else. Dams, I mean, they're good. They could control flooding. Yeah, I mean, it's one of those, you know, good news, bad news things here. You could control flooding downstream if you collect the water before it gushes down. Yes, it's going to fill in. It has a limited lifespan. And, of course, standing water is not very good in Egypt. Now you start winding up with schistosomiasis and a bunch of diseases that will not be found in running water, but are found in standing water. Wonderful. So you have all kinds of health problems also. So by and large, how can we manipulate it? Sometimes we build dams, and sometimes they're good, and sometimes they're bad. But all I can tell you guys here is, it's going to obviously play a role in the maintenance of poverty. Some species, if you add mud, raise the temperature of water, I mean, as we have done here, just cut the trees down. That's all you have to do. The temperature of the water will go up. And that will probably then knock out some of the species. If, you know, the species can only tolerate certain extremes of temperature, you do that and you're probably going to lose some species. Now you might say, fresh water, who cares? You got 98% salt water, 2% fresh water. You've got 30,000 species of fish on this planet. How are they distributed? Are there more in the ocean, more in fresh water, equal? 30,000. 98% is salt water. You know, tuna. 2% is freshwater, bass. 30,000 species, approximately 50-50. Half of the species of fish on this planet are in freshwater. And freshwater is the one that's taking a beating. So we might be losing species. So we don't have any more of the saber-toothed bloody, who cares, whatever. I mean, why do you need all these species? Hell, we got thousands, millions of species. What do you need them all for? Why do you need them? Where are my ecology guys? They're going to jump in with this answer. I can see it in their eyes. Right. How do we maintain balance in an ecosystem? And we use the word sustainability. What do ecologists use? Homeostasis. The ability of an ecosystem to stay the same. And one of the characteristics of that is, what species do you find in there and how many of them? There are obviously some creatures around here that are not homeostatic. Deer. They're all over the damn place, man. I've got deer that come onto this doe. Now I think I've seen her three of the last five. Nobody here, and she doesn't dump. And then leaves. I think my yard has become the town, you know, toilet or I don't know what the hell it is. That's a perfect example of animals that are totally out of control. I mean, there are so many damn deer out there, it's ridiculous. Way more than we ever had. It is not a homeostatic environment. Nature tends toward homeostasis. If it gets screwed up, it's usually due to us. We're the ones that tend to screw it up. We made life heaven for deer. We got rid of their predators. We give them winter food because they would starve otherwise. Now they come along and eat all your plants all winter long, and blah, 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 blah. We're going to be losing species, and why should we be worried? Species interact with each other. These guys eat these guys compete with those guys, and they keep the balance. You start eliminating species, you lose your balance. And I told my ecology class, we'll go out in the creek. Am I going to tell you how many tadpoles we're going to find? Am I going to tell you how many crayfish we're going to get? Am I going to tell you how many guppies we're going to get? We got to go out and look, because I can't tell you. Not homeostatic. Most of our, when we do this sort of thing and we mess up our fresh water, we are decreasing these species and we are decreasing homeostasis. So what happens if we lose some very important species? Oh, wow, yeah, I never really thought of that. Yeah, we could really be screwing this whole thing up. Absolutely. So we contribute to poverty and everything else. And just as a final note, I mean, if you attended last year, you heard all about the global warming thing, et cetera, et cetera. Nobody knows what's going to happen with global warming. Most of the predictions are you are going to change the rainfall patterns in the world. You may be changing the prevailing winds. Now your westerlies may not go westerly. Now your trade winds might not go that way. We don't know what's going to happen. It is conceivable that you are going to change the water distribution patterns on this planet. And maybe we will be like Southern California. where, you know, San Diego, where they pay like, I don't know, about a dollar a gallon or something for their water. They were in the desert. I mean, good Lord here. I mean, could things change here? Could we go from this nice high water area to much less? Or to more flooding? I mean, could our Midwest get less water? I mean, they get some rain, but they tap the groundwater. If they got rain, that'd be nice. What if there's no rain? What if they discharge the entire aquifer and there's no more water? What's that going to do to the price of crops? That could happen. We don't know. Hell, maybe California will become a forest. They might get tons more water. Who knows? We just don't know. That's our problem here. So right here, how are we going to redistribute that? I wish we knew. Maybe we can make some predictions. But our problem is we don't know. So my final note here, and I think the last one, Steve, just... we got to put Kim in there. I want to thank Kim Holt from our lab there. She's the one that put this whole mess together for me. I wrote down the words and she made English out of it. Last one, Steve? Yeah. If you really want to be part of the, as they used to say in the 60s, let's be part of the solution, not part of the problem. Your cause could change your lawn to the grasses that grow much less water. Zosia grass and others, they're working on plenty of them. I mean, collect water in a rain barrel. Just put it at the end of your downspout, water comes in, scoop that up, throw it on the plants. Wildfires, native, require no care. Well, that might not be that easy, I told you. You start stripping that area out, put wildflowers in there, watch out. The invasives may come in. There are some plants that will grow almost anywhere, and they just take over and drive out the native species. And of course, remember I mentioned the hidden water. In general, you lower your water, your hidden water, your water footprint, by feeding lower on the food chain. Eat more plant material. Because what you have to do is keep those plants alive, and they take a lot of water. Now, if you add to that, taking those plants and feeding them to the cattle, now you got this extra cost of that water there. So you eat meat, you're actually paying for even more water as you work your way along the food chain. If you eat lower on the food chain, generally speaking, you will lower your water footprint. And then, of course, the fertilizer, as we had mentioned, 3 times a year. I've been doing that for quite a while. As a matter of fact, even when they say, okay, put your setting there at 4, I usually drop it down to 2 and draw a little bit, and then maybe a day or two later come back and do it again. I had a neighbor when I lived in Sparkill, fertilize his lawn every weekend. Absolutely incredible. Every weekend. I mean, he had a beautiful lawn, don't get me wrong. But I said, Al, what are you doing here? I mean, you realize that this is all going to wash away. No, I'm going to sell the house. I got to have a nice little lawn. So of course, one day I approached him and I said, Al, you fertilize your plants every weekend. I do mine when I feel like every once in a while. And my lawn looks as good as yours. This was in January. We had a foot of snow on the But I got him. I said that. All right, we're pretty much done. Anybody have any questions?
I do.
Yes.
How is the creek looking now, since you've been putting so much
in? Well, as I said at the beginning here, it failed the test 95% of the time. It came out as contaminated water. Is it getting worse? Probably. That's what we would say. Just looking at the populations, how many species, how many do you catch? And as I said, if you said to me, we're going out today, are we going to catch mosquito fish? Are we going to catch shiners? Are we going to catch bass? I don't know. That's the problem. They should be there, but are they? I don't know. You're looking at a very stressed ecosystem.
And
no
is
problem.
There more water, less water, the same?
Around here, it's probably about the same. I have not seen anything suggesting that we have increased or decreased. I mean, we're kind of like a water homeostasis, I guess. That doesn't mean it's going to stay like that. I mean, that's a problem. You just don't know. It could easily change. Things have changed. Absolutely. Yes.
I know you mentioned eating lower on the food chain and meat. I know a huge problem that we're having is with the mass cattle practices we have in the Midwest, where you have these really densely populated